As a reward, we'll give now to the paper called Two Round Secure Multiparty Competition for Minimal Assumptions by Sanjay Garg and Akshay Srinivasan. And Akshay is going to give the talk.
Hi everyone, I'm Akshay. And I'm going to talk about Two Round Secure Multiparty Computation from Minimal Assumptions. This is based on joint work with Sanjay. Let me start this talk by describing the setting of two-party computation. So in this setting, there are two parties with private inputs x1 and x2 respectively, and they wish to compute a joint function f on their private inputs. The security notion that we want to guarantee here is that even if one of the parties, let's say, gets corrupted, it does not learn anything about the other party's input apart from what is leaked by this function. Secure two-party computation is one of the fundamental primitives in cryptography, and a whole lot of research effort has been put into to completely characterize it. So let me quickly summarize these results. We know that there are certain functionalities for which two rounds are necessary to securely compute them, meaning that they cannot be securely computed in a single round. On the positive side, we know that garbage circuits, along with a two-round oblivious transfer, gives a two-round protocol for securely computing any two-party functionality. So this result matches the lower bound in terms of round complexity. And furthermore, we know that the two-round OT is the minimal assumption from which we can construct a two-round two-party computation, as any two-round two-party computation implies a two-round OT. In this work, we are interested in the secure multi-party setting, where there are several parties with private inputs x1, x2, up to xn, and they wish to compute a joint function f on their private inputs. The security that we want to guarantee here is that even if a subset of the parties get corrupted, where the size of the subset would be as large as n minus 1, the corrupted parties do not learn anything about the honest party's inputs, apart from what is linked by this function. So secure multi-party setting is a more demanding setting than the two-party computation, and it's much harder to design protocols in the multi-party setting. So let me first recall what we know about secure multi-party computation protocols. Way back in 1987, almost 31 years ago, Goldrake, Mikali and Peterson gave a protocol for securely computing any multi-party functionality. However, the number of rounds of this protocol grows with the multiplicative depth of the circuit. And for circuits with large multiplicative depth, the number of rounds could be a large number. And a long line of work, starting with the seminal work of Beaver, Mikali and Rogaway in 1990, reduce the round complexity to a particular constant. And recently, there has been several works which constructed round optimal MPC protocol, where round optimality means two rounds. So the first construction was given by Garg et al. In 2014, and this was based on indistinguishability obfuscation. Later on, Gordon et al. Improved the assumptions to witness encryption. And then Eurocrypt 2016, Mukherjee and Wicks gave a protocol for computing any multi-party functionality in two rounds from learning with errors. And in last year's Eurocrypt, Boyle, Gilboa and Ishai gave a protocol for computing multi-party functions for a constant number of parties from the DDH assumption. And in Fox last year, we gave a protocol for computing any multi-party functionality based on standard assumptions on bilinear loops. So if you see all these constructions of two-round MPC protocol, you will see that there is a significant gap in the assumptions that are sufficient for constructing two-round MPC when compared to that of two-round 2PC. Specifically, we know constructions of two-round two-party computation from the minimal assumption that two-round OT exists, whereas all the prior constructions of two-round MPC somewhat required a structured algebraic assumptions. So this brings us to the main question, which is the focus of this work, which is, can we construct the two-round multi-party computation protocols from significantly weaker assumptions? So in this work, we show that we can construct a two-node protocol for securely computing any multi-party functionality from any two-node WBS transfer. So this closes a natural line of work for finding the minimal assumption required for constructing two-node MPC protocols. And specifically, it places two-node MPC in the same scale as that of two-node two-party computation as far as assumptions are concerned. So let me give you more details about the result. In the semi-honest setting, we get a construction of two-node MPC protocol from any two-node OT in the plain model. In the malicious setting, we get a construction of two-node MPC in the CRS model from any two-node maliciously secure OT in the CRS model. Interestingly, our malicious secure protocol does not require non-interactive zero knowledge proofs, whereas all the prior constructions additionally require NSX to get security in the malicious setting. So a corollary of this malicious protocol is that we get a two-node malicious secure MPC from DDH or LWU because we don't know constructions of NSX from these assumptions. And in a concurrent and an independent work, which will be hearing next, Benhamuda and Lin also obtained similar results as ours. Specifically, they obtained the same result in the semi-honest setting, that is, they construct a two-round MPC from any two-round OT in the plain model. In the malicious setting, they additionally require NSX on top of two-round maliciously secure OT. And they also have several interesting results in the plain model, that is, without any trusted set of assumptions, and I think Fabrice will be mentioning them. Okay. So, let me get to the main idea behind the result. The main idea is that of round compression. That is, we take an arbitrary round protocol P that securely computes a function F, and we compress the round complexity to just two broadcast rounds. So this might sound a little bit counterintuitive as how can we possibly compress an arbitrary round protocol without affecting its correctness or its security? So to explain this, I'll first consider a very simple toy protocol that computes a very simple functionality, and I'll tell you how to compress the round complexity of this protocol. Later I will say how to compress the round complexity of arbitrary computation protocols. So this toy protocol P computes a three-party functionality F that takes a bit A from the first party, bit B from the second party, bit C from the third party, and outputs three bits, A, A and B, and A and B and C. So all the parties get all these three bits as output. A very simple protocol that is secure, that securely computes this function is as follows. So the private inputs of the party 1 is A, which is a single bit, party 2 is B, and party 3 is C. And in the first round, the first party broadcasts A to the other two parties. And in the second round, the second party broadcasts A and B to the other two parties. And in the third round, the third party broadcasts A and B and C to the other two parties. So this is very simple protocol. And it's information theoretically secure, and it's secure against two corruptions. I'll be focusing just on the semi-honest model in the rest of the talk. So it's secure against passive corruptions of at most two parties. But unfortunately, this protocol runs in three rounds. And it's not clear how to compress the round complexity of this protocol into two rounds in the information theoretic setting. In this work, we'll throw in some computational tools and compress the round complexity of this protocol. The main computational tool that we'll be using is garbled circuits. So let me first recall garbled circuits. And garbled circuits was introduced in the seminal work of Yao. And it allows to encode a Boolean circuit F into a garbled circuit F tilde, along with a pair of labels for each input wire of this circuit F. So So physically there is one label corresponding to the bit 0 and another label corresponding to the bit 1. The garden circuit F tilde, along with the labels corresponding to the bits of an input X, allows one to evaluate F of X. And the security property is that the garden circuit, along with these labels, do not leak anything about F or X apart from just F of X. So let's now see how to compress the round complexity of this toy protocol, which is running in 3 rounds, to 2 rounds using garden circuit. So let me go over the high-level idea of a two-round protocol. So in the first round, the first party broadcasts A, which is same as the toy protocol. Whereas in the second round, in the two-round protocol, the second party garbles some circuit, which I will specify later. And it broadcasts this circuit to the other two parties, along with the labels for evaluating the circuit. Similarly, in the second round, the third party garbles two circuits, and I will specify the functionality of these two circuits later, and it garbles these two circuits and broadcasts these two circuits to the other two parties along with the labels for evaluating the first garble circuit. And these are all the interactions that are happening. So now the question is, how does this achieve round compression? So the answer to this question is that these two garble circuits somehow implement the second round of the toy protocol, and the final garble circuit implements the third round of the toy protocol. So given these two garble circuits, every party can locally evaluate them to obtain the output of the second round and the output of the third round. And this is how we compress the round complexity of this toy protocol. So let me go over in some more detail on how do these garble circuits somehow implement a communication round. So let me take the example of the second round, which is implemented by two garble circuits. The first garble circuit, which is generated by the second party, takes as input A, which was broadcasted in the first round, and B, which is the private input of the second party. And the third party's garble circuit takes the private input C of the third party. So the main idea behind the result is that we design a mechanism wherein the second party broadcasts A and B to the garble circuit, and the third garble circuit somehow listens to what this broadcast is. So in some sense, we enable the garble circuits to talk with each other. So once this garble circuit has listened to A and B, it can pass on this information to the garble circuit which is implementing the third round of the protocol. So it can pass on C and A and B, and the third round garble circuit just outputs A and B and C. So this is how we achieve round compression at a high level. And in our previous work, we achieved this mechanism wherein the garble circuits can talk with each other using a special purpose witness encryption scheme built on standard assumptions on bilinear maps. However, in this work, we'll just rely on two round of BPS transfer to do this. So let us now see how to make the garble circuits to talk with each other using a two round loop. So let me first recall an oblivious transfer. So an oblivious transfer is a protocol between two parties, a sender and a receiver. So the sender's inputs are M0 and M1, which are two strings, and the receiver's input is a choice bit. And at the end of the protocol, the receiver learns the message MB, and the sender does not learn anything about the bit B, and the receiver does not learn anything about the message M1. That is the security that we want to get. So in this talk, we'll be focusing on two rounds of BPS transfers, where the first round is sent from the receiver to the sender, and somehow encodes this choice bit. In the second round, the sender sends the message, which somehow encodes his strings M0 and M1. In this work, we crucially rely on the fact that given the sender's message and the randomness used for generating the first round receiver's message, one can recover the message corresponding to the bit. And we know constructions of two-round RTBS transfer from a variety of number theoretic assumptions such as DDH, quadratic reciprocity, and even lattice-based assumptions such as learning results. So let us see how to use a two-round RTBS transfer to compress the round complexity of this toy program. So let me just go over the protocol. So in the first round, the first party broadcasts A, which is same as before. But in the first round, now the second party broadcasts two messages. So the first, there are two receiver OT messages. The first message encodes 0 and B, where B is the private input of the second party. The second receiver OT message encodes 1 and B as its choice. So this is the first round of the protocol. And in the second round, as I mentioned before, the sender sends the second party sends a garbage circuit. And the third party generates two garbage circuits. So the one thing that I have not yet mentioned is what are the functions computed by this garbage circuit so that they can implement the second and the third round. So let me explain these functions. So let me start with the first garbage circuit of the third party. So this garbage circuit takes as input the bit C, which is the private input of the third party, and it has a bunch of values which are hardwired. It has the bit A, which is the first round message of the first party. It has the first round OT messages of the second party hardwired. It has two sets of labels, input labels of garbage circuit. So looking ahead, these labels will be the input labels of the second garbage circuit generated by this third party. So these are the hardwired values. Let me explain the output of this garbage circuit. So the output consists of two components. The first component is the label corresponding to the input C. The second component is the interesting component, and it's a sender's OT message which is generated as follows. So depending on this choice bit A, it either chooses the first message or the second message. So if A is 0, then it chooses the first message, otherwise it chooses the second message. In either case, the bit that is encoded by the chosen message is A and B. So it corresponding to that first round OT message, it generates the second round OT message with the input being the labels corresponding to 0 and the label corresponding to 1. So this is the output of the first garbage circuit of the third part. So it's still not clear how this enables the garbage circuits to communicate. And for that, we rely on the second party's garbage circuit. So the second party's garbage circuit takes as input A and B, and it has the randomness used for generating the first round OT message and the second round OT message hardware. So omega 0 is the randomness used for generating the message corresponding to 0 and B and 1 and omega. So this circuit's output again consists of components. The first component is the second round message of the toy protocol, which is A and B. We call that the second round message consists of A and B, and the third round message has to be A and B and C. So it outputs the second round message in the clear, but it somehow needs to communicate A and B to the other party's garbage circuit. So it does this communication by outputting the randomness corresponding to omega A. So given the randomness corresponding to A and this sender's OT message, one can recover the label corresponding to A and B. And this is precisely the message that we wanted the garbage circuit to communicate to the other garbage collector. So the garbage circuit which has to speak outputs the randomness corresponding to one of the OT messages. The garbage circuit that has to listen outputs the sender OT message. So given this and this, one can obtain the label corresponding to A and B, which is the message that we wanted to first communicate. And given these two labels, one can evaluate the third party's garbage circuit with the label corresponding to C and the label corresponding to A and B to obtain the third round output A and B and C. And this is how we achieve the round compression of a fiber. So given these garbage circuits, every party can locally evaluate them to obtain the output A and B. And then using this randomness, they can recover the label corresponding to A and B and then obtain the third round output A and B. So this seems fine just for this five protocol, but now the question is how do we compress the round complexity of an arbitrary protocol? So for this purpose, let me just focus on the case of three parties again, but it generalizes to larger number of parties. And we will consider any MPC protocol in the following model. So in each round, a single party computes a circuit C1 on its private input and the messages that was received previously, and then communicates the output of the circuit to the other two parties. So let's say in the first round, the first party computes a circuit C1 on its own private state, and then obtains the output and communicates it to the other two parties. In the second round, let's say the third party computes a circuit C2 on its private state and the message that was received in the first round, and then communicates the output to the other two parties. And this goes on for T rounds. And it is very easy to see that any MPC protocol can be transformed into this form. So in order to compress the round complexity of this protocol, we will again use the same idea wherein we implement each round using a set of garbage circuits. But now we enhance this talking and listening capacity so that they work for the arbitrary circuits instead of a single gate. So the idea is very similar to the single gate setting. I won't be having time to go over the details of this. How we generalize it, and I would encourage you to look at that. Okay, so this is how we compress the round complexity of an arbitrary protocol, and this helps in achieving the desired result of constructing a two-round MPC. So to conclude, we gave a two-round protocol for secure multi-party computation from any two-round OT, and this is the minimal assumption from which we can construct MPC protocol. In a follow-up work which is going to appear in this year's crypto, we gave a protocol where the number of public key operations is independent of the circuit size that is being computed. All the previous constructions, including the construction that I just described, add a property that the number of public key operations grows with the circuit size, and that is something that we want to avoid. Here we have a construction where the number of public key operations is independent of the circuits that is being computed. So some of the open questions from our work are, can we improve the communication complexity? So currently the communication complexity grows with the computational complexity of the protocol that we are compressing. So it's not clear whether this is necessary, so can we improve the communication? Another interesting open problem is to have a concretely efficient two-round MPC protocol. That would have a great effect in practice. And that's it. Thank you for your attention.